Right. When did you meet? How did you meet? Where did you meet?
We met in 1990. Was it 93?
Yeah.
We met in Chester, where early in 90s. The bar where I was working.
Yeah, Chad was the bar manager, and we used to get free beer.
Yeah, and then the free beers led to hanging out and listening to music and talking about bands and stuff, didn't
it?
And
talking about all the bands that were out at the time, and then getting a guitar out while listening to other bands.
Yeah.
Inventing the idea of getting a band together when there was actually no band.
That was it, wasn't it? Yeah.
Yeah, the band existed for probably about 2 years before.
It was actually an idea for a while, wasn't it?
Yeah.
When was Mansun, when did you come up with the name and it sort of, you know, solidify it and you actually had a group?
Well, the name originally was, I think it was originally just after Charles Mansun, wasn't it? And then we decided to change it.
Because we were sat one night, weren't we? We'd been trying to find a name and discovered how hard it is to find a cool name for a band, hadn't we? And then we were sitting watching TV and a documentary came on about Charles Mansun, didn't it? And, and Paul just said, Mansun, that's quite a cool name, isn't it?
It seemed good at
the
time.
We thought it was good to me, yeah.
Could you play?
Yeah, we could.
Yeah.
But that was about it, really. the rest of the people that came in and out sort of couldn't and dropped by the wayside, and we went through the sort of Spinal Tap exploding drummer period, but theirs lasted for about 20 years, but ours lasted about over 18 months.
Yeah.
And
I think we convinced ourselves that we'd be able to teach other people to play musical instruments well enough to be in a band with us, didn't we?
Okay, another one straight away, guys. Coming along, just pat us. So Stowe, even more back behind the beat. Getting slightly better each time. Just that second note, bump, boom. Really slow down.
Here we go.
Because he was playing crap before Christmas, he reached the point where he didn't know about this and that he couldn't do legacy. So at Ridge Farm he sort of learnt all that and now he can do it, but he can only do it shitling.
Because we all had jobs, we could sort of finance recording some tracks, so we recorded four tracks. We all came down to London and booked into like the cheapest professional studio we could find and recorded four tracks in a day. And people would sort of come in to us when we were rehearsing and say, that's really good, and, you know, have you thought about putting a record out? And we were simultaneously having this idea to just print up our own 7-inch and send it out. And that's pretty much what we did, and Radio 1 played it. Played on Radio 1, everything changed then. It just escalated from there, but this record come out and there was no band and we had to learn on the road, which was, we didn't even realise that like our second or third gig was at the Camden Underworld on on Camden Live, which is live on radio, and it was we sort of shut ourselves in the foot. We knew ourselves that we weren't a live act yet. It was only when we got into the business of being a band that we realised what it took to be a good live act, and that probably happened about a year after we started touring, and that was just due to the force of our will to just try and win people over, because we were getting a really bad press reaction, and that was absolutely justified because we couldn't play. And I remember, you know, getting NME every week and it'd go, "Mansun, they can't play," and I'd go, "Yeah, I know." It wasn't like, you know, there was slack.
It wasn't the shock, was it?
It was the shock, no.
Do you have fond memories of those first gigs?
Yeah, I mean, it was just, I remember the splitter van just turning up at our house and getting on it, and even that was amazing.
Yeah.
Just getting on the bus for the first time.
I think the truth is, like, that, you know, the touring you do early on, that's like as good as touring gets, to be honest. And when you move away from that, you get to the point where you're doing, like, big production tours and you're taking lighting and PA and catering and all that, and all you really want to do is at that point is get back in a little van and play little clubs, you know.
Touring abroad, you went to, you know, did some of the interesting places. Nice memories of these places: Japan, Hong Kong.
Yeah, good memories.
We're in Japan. This is still Tokyo. It's a lovely day. Behind you, you can see buildings, and ahead of you, you can see buildings. Taxi cab. Let's go.
Turning up in Japan the first time ever, that'll be something I'll remember forever. It was just, I mean, the most sort of amazing thing, because it's just sort of, it's just Disneyland, you know what I mean? It's because it's so very, very different from, I mean, you can go to a lot of places and there's a lot of similarities to home, and that was the first place I think we went where it was a case of, wow, this is just nothing like anything I've ever seen before.
Hello?
Hello?
Hiya.
Hi.
Yeah? Cool. I'm in a van. I'm on a mobile phone. Yeah, we're just going to HMV to do a big signing sesh.
Yeah,
that's it, this is the last thing.
Matt, we're all drunk.
I'm not.
I am.
Hi. Are we drunk or high?
Hi.
Drugs are amazing out in Japan. Dead easy to get. I didn't say I wouldn't take drugs through customs, bought them when I was here. Oh, that's stupid.
I'm going to play the guitar in Mansun.
Right, you don't
have a
piano there.
Hello, I'm Andy, and I'm the drummer.
Drummer, not Andy.
Konnichiwa, I'm Paul, I'm the singer.
The singer, Paul.
I'm Stowe, and I'm the cameraman. I'm the bass player.
Cameraman to bassist no Stowe desu. Did your rival Oasis, Blur, or Coolest Baker, or...?
Everyone keeps saying to us that there's like a Mansun Cooler Shaker rivalry like there was between Blur and Oasis, but I mean, you know, I don't know, no people seem to know about it in England, but everyone seems to think that it's us versus Cooler Shaker in Japan.
So you don't think
of that? I don't know much about them really.
If you were a woman and you had to choose one, you know, from the other three to marry or to go out with,
Okay, all right, I'd have anyone except Chad.
Chad, what would you say? Oh, oh.
You've seen that the Radiohead video where they're just being asked the same question over and over again. You probably had to do loads of promo, did you, out there?
There was one point, wasn't there, where I can't remember where we were, but it might have been in Japan because of the, because in Japan it is quite relentless when you do the promotional sort of visits, and you're doing kind of what, like 12 hours a day or something of solid interviews with a break for lunch, and it is literally the same questions. One interview we did kind of lighten the monotony of it a bit,
we
by
lied,
starting
basically.
To yeah.
So how did you come up with the name Mansun? Is there any special meaning behind that?
When we started the band, we were all into Band Full of Earth, and one of the songs which we're into is called A Man Called Sun.
I see.
And we were thinking of calling ourselves A Man Called Sun, but it was a bit long. So we just shortened it down.
Shortened it to Mansun. Okay, that's a pretty good meaning.
Well, Mansun is also a serial killer in LA.
How have you enjoyed your trip?
Oh, that's very good. Worked me ass off.
You did. Did well. This is only 3 days, but I think it's one of the hardest promos we've done.
Definitely.
Tuesday was a killer.
Today's the hardest day we've done ever.
And what are we up to later? What's the finale of this trip?
Gonna get a few beers here, maybe go down to Lexington Queens.
Lexington Queens would be good.
Gonna boogie in and then back to the hotel, a few glasses of champagne, crash out, play in the morning, back on the plane, back to England, gotta make a video.
Cool.
General rock and roll.
Cool, so sign off.
Paul Draper signing off in Tokyo, sayonara.
We had no idea the first album was going to be successful like it was. I don't think anyone knew it was going to happen like that. I think everyone would just sort of wrote us off as like just this insane, what the hell are they doing band type malarkey. And we just finished the first one and went straight back in the studio. We picked all the wrong songs for singles. And the record company were telling us, you know, they were right in retrospect. But, you know, I suppose I was just too headstrong, wasn't I, to change what we're doing. And it just happened that we went straight into the studio with no songs and we just made it up on the spot. It was just so intricate and detailed, and me as sort of acting as the band's internal producer, if you like, I was overthinking everything. I mean, I'd probably lost the plot pretty much by that point.
I'm so boring, my clothes wanna keep someone else, want someone cool. Tax on cigarettes treats my cancer. These things elevate me above animals. I feel like being a girl, 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 being a girl.
When it got to Little Kicks, I remember coming back off the 6 tours and being just completely drained, but just kept going and kept going. And now realise in retrospect, when your mind gets clouded by everything that's going on in rock and roll, you can't write, you can't focus on what you're doing it. But I had enough sort of capacity to write songs, but I was writing songs for the band. I was writing songs to be in the music industry, and not the first two albums, which was we were just doing our own thing within the music industry and sort of putting two fingers up to it. Did get to the point where we were physically falling to bits, I think, all of us, didn't we? But
I mean, don't kind of, without wanting to say anything that sounds too dramatic, but I think we were pretty emotionally drained.
Yeah, I was.
It's
easy to look back now and think, wow, you know, you're in a good place in your life, and why the hell didn't we carry on? But you can only react to the situation you're in, and we didn't see any route out. If we'd have kept going, you're talking about a band who was going to go and tour and put an album out, and the stress of that and not knowing whether it would have worked or not was just something none of us were in a place in our minds that we could do it, and it literally just imploded. I couldn't take any more, really. I mean, it wasn't my decision. You'd had enough. Everyone had had enough. I don't think anyone wanted anything to do with it. None of us wanted to be there. It was inevitable, really. It became too much for us in the end. There's lots and lots of little elements, and like, there's no point in going into the individual elements, but I think we'd all just completely lost the plot by the end, and the only way to salvage us as like human beings and people was to just get out of it.
Emotion is a bitter fate. Won't be here so long.